السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله، الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستهديه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فهو المهتدي، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن سيدنا محمدًا عبده ورسوله، صلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. Dear brothers and sisters, we continue our topics in religious studies and the theories of religion. I introduced for these in many occasions, so I will not repeat myself. Today we are going to study anthropology. And anthropology means the science of man, studying human beings from the beginning, the primitive cultures, through all the ages, from the Stone Age to the Copper Age, to the Bronze Age, to the Agriculture Age and the Industry Age and the Technology Age and the Nuclear Age. So all these human existence of the planet Earth for God knows over 100,000 years for the cognitive man, this is a specialty of anthropology, and we will see what anthropology has to say about religions. Just a little background, and you know the background also always helps. We call it sometime in the context, and the historic context for the anthropology studies is very important to know. You know, the context issue, you have to be keen on it whenever you face a situation. Even in the deen, when you read an ayah, you have to understand what the context and what's asbab al-nuzul. That explain a lot the meaning of the ayah. Otherwise, you might reach different interpretation and different meaning. Imagine yourself in the Revolutionary War with George Washington, and he's given the orders in New England for the Minutemen in Concord and other areas to shoot the Redcoats, to shoot the British. We understand that was a Revolutionary War, and the heroes were the Founding Fathers and the militia and so on. And we know the enemy was the king and the abusive laws issued 3,000 miles away. But when everything is over, imagine nowadays somebody in the rural areas in New England see a British tourist and he start shooting at him because George Washington said so, or anyone with a red coat, you start shooting at him because that was the order for the Minutemen or for those militias. It's, of course, that's total madness. Unfortunately, this been applied to Islam. Everything, whoever has interest to distort the picture of Islam, journalists, media, etc., they treat Islam the same way I mentioned about treating the out of context. And all what is related to fighting wars, it's like the Revolutionary War. It is Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his few followers against whom? It wasn't against Christian. It wasn't against Jews. It was against the pagans, al-mushrikeen, the people of Quraysh, the family and the tribe of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So, and the location is Mecca and Al-Masjid Al-Haram. So when you take things out of its context, you can have the interpretation we have nowadays about Islam, which is totally false. The context and the issue of the background is very important. I mean, even in the animal kingdom, you know, the cats are very difficult to control, very difficult to make them walk in a line or to herd them, as they say, because they are so free-spirited and individualistic in unbelievable way. I remember the Lady and the Tramp, one of the Disney movies, and how that babysitter brought two Siamese cats, and they created havoc in the house and destroyed almost everything, from the curtains to the pots and so on. But if you want to control cats and change the whole thing and the whole picture, just tilt the ground 15 degrees where they are walking on. Immediately you find them in line and you find them controllable. The context is something very important. And all of us, we need to know Asbab al-Nuzul. We need to know the seerah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to understand how, what's the meaning of this? What's the truth about issues? The background and the context of anthropology goes back several hundred years to the time of the Copernicus. What he came with is a revolution which shattered Europe and the church, where the earth was supposed to be the center of the whole universe and the footstep of God, and you all these pictures. And here we have a astronomer or physicist who tell us that the earth is a speck in this universe. That was something very important and very big with this scientific revolution. And then comes in 1859, or before then, at the time of the French Revolution and the Enlightenment, here the background and the context of optimism and hope and the concept of progression, the progressive forces, that mankind is going in a progressive way from worse to better. Our friend Will Durant mentioned that Marquis de Condorcet, he was one of the noblemen who apparently were under the wrath of the terror leaders, Robespierre and Marat and Danton. And he was chased, and eventually the police caught him, and he committed suicide. He rather dead than to go to the guillotine. He wrote, at the time when he was hiding in one of the villages in an old woman house in the attic, he wrote, according to Will Durant, the most optimistic book ever penned by the hand of man. Sketch of a tableau of the progressive of or progression of a human spirit, described the recent liberation of science from shackles of superstition, glorified the triumphant of Newton laws, and hoped that with this universal scientific education, all social problems will, at the close of the next century, will be solved. He was very optimistic and hopeful. And he stated that there's no limits in progress except the duration of the globe which we are placed on. And progress is domination of or diminution of chaos by mind and purpose subdued into law and control of matter with the will of mankind. So this issue of progress is in the background of the 17, 18, or 19th century, which we have to be keen on. The second thing of the background of anthropology is Darwin. Charles Darwin, being a very quiet man, did not attack nobody. He attacked no religion. But his scientific, which they called it scientific, probably it's more an observation than anything else, came up with the, in the year 1859, with the theory of evolution and so on. So Will Durant is telling us, if he was right, the year 1859 should be in the memory of everyone. It's the beginning of modern thought and the new world picture. In Darwin theories and so on, we see that nature became natural selection, became a struggle for existence, and ruthless elimination of the unfit. It is the power and the forces of evolution. So for those who can quantitate and qualitate things, they would tell you the revolution of Darwinism is not less than the revolution of Copernicus. Copernicus reduced the earth to a speck, and Darwin reduced man to another animal species on the planet Earth and follows the same rules applied to all animals. With this in mind, we know that the authors of the anthropology were very much influenced. Also, I'll take a little break and talk about a movie. In my yesteryears, I was a movie buff. This is what you say. When I was a young man in studying in the high school and university, I mean, I knew about Hollywood quite a bit. So one of the fascinating movies called Apocalypse Now, it came into theaters in the year 1979, I think. That movie is based, it's an epic war film, which is adaptation or loose adaptation or borrowed from a book written by Joseph Conrad. Joseph Conrad was East European person who migrated to England and changed his name to Joseph Conrad. And he had one of the very influential books called The Heart of Darkness in the year 1899, talking about the dark side of humans and their psyche. And basically he was studying the European colonization of Africa. And specifically in that book, he was talking about the Belgian emperor who was apparently responsible for killing millions and their control of the Congo and so on. But the adaptation for Apocalypse Now, the Francis Ford Coppola, he changed the subject to the American interventionism in Southeast Asia. So the movie was in the wake of the Vietnam War and so on. In that movie, we don't have to talk about it. He tried so hard and he succeeded to tell you the terror of war and killing and so on. But why I mentioned this movie is just to tell you about a point has to do with our subject. That at the end of the movie, where one of the colonels was, his name Kurtz, he turned mad and started being a danger for everyone, the Viet Cong and Vietnamese and the soldier, the American soldiers and so on. And the special part of the army sent somebody to kill him. in his madness. So that's what the whole story is about, and of course all the actions and the terror of war, you can see it there. At the end of that movie, when Martin Sheen was entering the room of that mad colonel, Kurtz, he found on his table two books. Those two books has to do with anthropology. The first one was From Ritual to Romance by a lady with the name Willie Watson. She is, I think, British, was born in the year 1850 and died in the year 1828 or so. And the second book is called The Golden Bough, written by James Frazer. James Frazer is one of two names associated with the discipline of anthropology. They were the ones who advanced that knowledge. I know probably Socrates or Aristotle talked about humans, but as a discipline, anthropology, Frazer is credited big time with his teacher, I think, Tyler, before him. So The Golden Bough, written by James Frazer, was on the desk of Colonel Kurtz when Willard, Martin Sheen, he went there to kill him. And we know when Kurtz died, he was uttering few lines of poetry written by T.S. Eliot. And the last two words he uttered is the horror, the horror. So it's very sad and dark moments. T.S. Eliot, as we know, his ancestors probably came with the Mayflower, God knows, from Somerset, England. And his grandfather moved west to Missouri, to St. Louis. And T.S. Eliot lived there his childhood. And then he went to Harvard and had his degrees and so on. Then he migrated back to England. And he took the citizenship of the British kingdom. And when he died, he was his ashes were buried in Somerset, where his great-grandparents came from. So it's like a cycle. T.S. Eliot won a Nobel Prize in 1948 for his poetry and novels or plays. And one of the important poetry called The Wasteland. The Wasteland, it's like 400 pages of poetry, and it was heavily influenced, as T.S. Eliot said, by these two authors, especially The Golden Bough. And so today our topic is anthropology, and we will go through it through the lenses of Tyler and Edward Tyler and James Frazer. Both of them are British, and both of them had the title of Sir, and you know, their books been widely spread and influenced too many people. So the anthropology is the general study of human nature and trying to study all the primitive cultures, especially of the newly discovered areas of the corners of the earth, since we cannot go back with a clock on Europe or the Middle East and, you know, those areas which carried over thousands of years the torch of civilization, from the Persian to the Greeks to the Romans to the Muslims and to Europe, the modern Europe, and so on. So you go to all these Amazon areas where there is tribes, they never been contaminated, let's use that word, with civility and the West or the major civilization. And of course, Australia and New Guinea and many areas in Africa also. And they tried by studying the primitive societies to understand the human nature, why he believes and why he acts the way he did, and so on, to try to come up with some laws or some explanations. So they were trying to find a common ground for the human nature. And they initially, like Tyler and Frazier, they called them armchairs anthropologists, because they did not leave their desks or their rooms or studies to explore the world. They gathered information from the books of and the stories comes with the sailors and from many, many sources, and they studied them and analyzed them and so on. Edward Taylor lived from the year 1832 to the year 1917 and came up with a book after all these efforts called The Primitive Culture. And he talked about the savage philosopher. And he found that all these civilization, if there's anything common beside being humans, and they have the physique of humans and behavior of humans, they found religion is a common thing among all cultures. And they found the religious centers or places, every culture on earth, every city, every village, you cannot escape founding some place, whatever name they call it, as a center of the religion and the practices of religion. So, and he found that all religions believe in the supernatural, and trying that savage philosopher or the elderly of the village or something, try to explain the world. This is what they can come up with to explain the world around them and so on. James Frazier, who was born in 1854 and died in the year 1941, written a monumental work. This is a book, I mentioned the title, The Golden Bough. It started with two volumes in the year 1899 and ended up to be 12 volumes, thousands of pages, almost talking about every culture, every myth, every society in the world, collected this massive work in this book, which was very influential, The Golden Bough. Of course, he depended also on some earlier books like The Age of Fables for author with the name Bunt Finch. It happened that I have the book. It's like 1,000 pages, The Age of Fable. And whenever I read about some mythology which interests me, I go to that book and I find that mythology and where does it come from and what it means. So Frazier attempted to define the shared elements in religious belief among all the societies and human stages, and came into a conclusion which we will mention in a short while, that there was a progression. That's why I mentioned the background. At that time, everything is progressive, everything is evolving, evolution theory, the background of the 18th and 19th century. And that this primitive explanation of the world by the magic shamans, or whatever you want to call these, he called them, or Tyler called them, the savage philosopher, to try to understand who they are and where, from where and to where, and what's the meaning of life, or what we're supposed to do. it progressed from magic to religion as we know it, especially after writing down the scripture and literature and so on. And then came the age of enlightenment and science, which in most of those anthropologists, like our friends from previous lectures, their background is denial of religion altogether, or denial of the church, or enemies of the established organized religion. So they felt, since science is an endeavor where you try in objective scientific way, pursuing the truth through the agencies of the mind, reason, induction, deduction, observation, reproducing the facts in the lab, and so on. So this is the best way to reach the truth of the matters. And that savage philosopher was doing the same thing, but it happened that he did not have a telescope or a microscope or any lab or any tools of what we have nowadays. Also was trying to understand his existence. So magic became religion and scripture, and then come science and the modern ages. And they studied all the fertility cults, the human sacrifices, the mythology of the Titans on the Olympics and the dying gods, and they studied the symbols, and they studied the periodic sacrifice of sacred king. And this is one of the myths, the Golden Bough, that how the younger ambitious person goes to the jungle and cut that branch, and he brings it back to the city and he kills the old king. This myth goes back far deeper than they thought, because the first one who mentioned this, one of the Roman historians. And also in that book, you find the legends of rebirth and the cyclical events on Earth, like the shortest day in the year in the winter, and the spring, and the rebirth of everything, and so on. All these phenomena helped to this development of human understanding. It started from animism. It started from dreams and from death of loved one. And from that developed the feeling that there is spiritual world and spiritual being. And here where the anthropologist said that we have to understand the myth and mythology not as a nonsense or bad science. It is stresses that it helps to explain how they thought. This is their instrument. This is what they have to explain things. And also he reached a conclusion, Fraser, or the idea of the survivals. And this is very important to know, that there are many cultural patterns that persisted beyond the time where they were invented or presented and becomes irrelevant later on. Like take the Christmas tree. That goes far beyond or before Christianity to the paganism of Europe and even before. It has to do with the rebirth and the new spring and so on. But it continued to exist till nowadays, in a different interpretation and meaning. So this is, for Fraser, he calls the idea of survivals. And for us also, many of the sects we have, and you know all this endeavor, it's an introduction to studying the Islamic sects. We have sects based all of it on issues which is, it's irrelevant nowadays, and doesn't make any sense. But the people attached to it their life, become a central of their lives and action and deeds and sacrifices, etc. So this is a very important point. When Fraser published his book, it made a big shock wave in England, in Britain, and scandalized the public, and he received big heat from that book, obliged him, because in these patterns, there was the theology of the Christianity, you know, been put as one of these phenomena, and so on. So he had obliged, apparently, or his publisher, to put it in the index at the end, in the appendix, and the abridged copy of the Golden Bough, they eliminated any mention to Christianity in it because of the backlash they received from the public as, you know, heresy or whatever. This anthropology continued to develop in the 19th and 20th century. Fraser and Tyler lived in the second half of the 19th century. In the 20th century, the anthropologist went far deeper than observation of these primitive societies. And they went first step, they got out of their armchairs in the Victorian age, and they went to the field, they went to Australia, they went to Amazon. And it's unfortunately most of them were accompanying the occupiers of the colonial age. And in their background, their fellow countrymen who are military and threatening the population. So their studies were influenced by this military might and changed. Their study was distorted because those natives were scared. And they know this guy coming, obliging them to tell what the secret of their religion and so on, but, and they know the garrison is not far away and they can erase their villages. So the person who, those are the functionalists who went there to study, like Malinowski. Then more sophisticated researchers, they tried to go to Amazon and try to be like non-existing. So they won't affect the village or the society in any way, being white men coming from Europe, try to their presence to be at minimum and study their religions and their behavior. And this is developed. And we have later on development of symbolic anthropology, where they try to focus on the signs and the symbols and the mental construct of all these things and their importance and so on. Then after the that comes the, you see they are going deeper and deeper in the human psyche or their in the human endeavor to see where is the religion come from. They went too deep all the way to the language. And in the language, we have two definitions, the lang, which means like English or French or Arabic, and the parole, which means the speaking and the utterance. And we have two branches of anthropology, the one which followed the lang, like Levi Strauss, and the one which followed the parole, like Geertz, Clifford Geertz, and those are called the structuralists. At any rate, anthropology is a science or discipline taught in the universities, colleges, for courses, probably takes a year or 2 years. We cannot summarize it all in few seconds or a few minutes or a few hours. But we have to mention that in the anthropology, study of religion, they found progression, they found stages from primitive animalistic and stages to the magic stage and the savage philosopher stage, all the way to the scriptural religions, which has holy books and so on, from the Veda and the Indian, all the way to the three monotheistic religions, like Judaism, Christianity, and Islam. And then they believe that nowadays, in the age of enlightenment, the last 300 years, science took the stage. And they thought that science will solve everything. But the facts, and thank God we live to be in the 21st century, all these progressive ideas did not materialize. That guy who was killed in the years of terror, he did not witness, you know, the rest of what happened in the 18th century, 19th century, and 20th century, and World War I and World War II. So no problem has been solved with all this advancement in science. In anthropology, of course, there's a lot of critique of these ideas and so on, which very legitimate and needs to be addressed. And we have to mention that this book, The Golden Bough, has influenced great minds in the West till nowadays in the postmodernism area. And it influenced or inspired creative literature and influenced several of the poets and thinkers like Robert Graves and Butler Yeats and T.S. Eliot, who wrote The Wasteland. Also, he influenced Sigmund Freud and Thomas and James Joyce, and of the last century authors, Ernest Hemingway and D.H. Lawrence, and of course, the master of mythology, Joseph Campbell, who died only recently. And Joseph Campbell was one of the advisors or consultants on movies like Star Wars, and based on what he knows about mythology and the power of mythology. I think he has a book, The Hero with 1,000 Faces, or like. So this is what I summarized the most I can do with the discipline of anthropology, and hopefully we will continue our journey in the study of the theories of religions. And hopefully next week we will talk about some positive, bright pictures, started with our friend Immanuel Kant and his school of phenomenology. That's very encouraging, and it's very positive, and I think we will enjoy it when we know it. So I'll stop here and ask your forgiveness. The topic is too long, and I couldn't condense it more than that without compromising many of the issues. And hopefully, when we finish this endeavor of studying the theories of religion, we will try to see what Islam says about all these theories, which are, they're not science, it's not math, it's not like physics, it's not like 2 + 2 = 4. These are inspiration or ideas or viewpoints or you know, insights, which helps. They are like tools in a box. When we come to study why there are so many religions on earth, why we have denominations, why we have new religions, why do we have sects, why do we have cults, these tools will help us to understand human beings and what they're doing. And we will dispel any magic. And of course, we are going to talk from the lens of Islam, the lens of the Quran and the hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Nobody can escape the vantage point. We are not born in the air or in nowhere to have that fourth dimension or God viewpoint. We're humans, we are attached to Earth, and we occupy certain vantage point, but we will see that how Islam really beautifully put things in perspective. And there's truth everywhere, you know, and Islam is the middle ground, which is a common denominator with all the truths present everywhere, and has the most of the collection of the truths in it. Islam, if you draw on a canvas a dark or a broad brush with any color you want, let's use the color green in the middle, and go 1,400 years, all the ideas in the world from all religion or philosophers, and see the progression, how humanity progressing towards better treatment of each other. I know it's not perfect and might take another 10,000 years to be perfect, but no doubt that humanity is living the best of its time, regardless what you say about wars, killing, crimes, terrorism, everything. We are living in the best age, where there is something called crimes against humanity, there's something called human rights, you have lawyers, you have, you know, you can address your grievances in a civilized manner, and so on. So in all this progression, over the last 1,400 years, and you go to study every factor in it, taking care of animals, taking care of children, taking care of women, taking care, all of them come closer to that broad brush, which was drawn by the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the middle ground. Let me pick up one issue without meaning anything beside explaining this point, the issue of the discrimination based on race. In Islam, we know from the Quran, from the hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that nobody is better than nobody. Black, white, any, you know, all of these signs of God's greatness. So, and the only criteria for who is best is the one who does good to others. Inna akramakum indallahi atqakum. Taqwa means to fear God and to do what God commands of you, taking care of your neighbors, friends, human beings at large. Slavery. Islam addresses this issue brilliantly. Even professors of university cannot do it. We know the proclamation, the Emancipation Proclamation, and all of this, of course, replaced a problem with another problem. Slavery is bad, and we know that economy is connected to slavery, and we know when, with the signature, slaves became free in societies, that freedom meant nothing, and it became troublesome for, because they did not, they were not given the support needed to lift themselves up, and led to, you know, age of discrimination, and from war, the civil war, all the way to the civil rights movement, and so on. And till now, we're still suffering. Islam, when they solved this problem of slavery, they put that principally, that's wrong, shouldn't happen. They analyzed what's, and made it unlawful to enslave any human beings. We are left with the prisoners of wars. And here the language might use the same word as slave, but they are prisoners of war. And the prisoners of war was the only burden on the society, that unavoidable wars were happening everywhere, like nowadays. And that problem been solved by adopting the servant, the slaves, into the family. And this is the concept of mawla. And you find here the slave, he's free, and his children are free, but he's not thrown into the wild society without support. He's part of the family. He has his own name. He doesn't have the name of the old master. And he was nurtured. All his needs, wants been provided. And of course, take one generation to get rid of this situation. And you find the children of those mawlas or mawali became professors. And you see this in the first stage after the companions, the tabi'in. I mentioned this story twice because it happened with Hisham ibn Abd al-Malik when he summoned Ibn Shihab al-Zuhri, and he told him, who is the professors of the Sharia? Who is the professor who are teaching in the great mosques in Mecca, Medina, Egypt, Syria, Iraq? And he counted like over 22 of them. All of them were children of slaves. He was the only one who was from the Arabs. All of them were children of the slaves. The same story happened with the nephew of Al-Mansur with the name Musa ibn Isa. He was a nephew of Mansur, and he was a regional director or governor. And he summoned one of those scholars of the Tabi'in. Forgot his name, Sha'bi, I think, Sha'bi. And he asked him also, who are the professors from Khurasan all the way to North Africa? And he mentioned every professor in every center, from Mecca to Medina to Damascus to Baghdad to Cairo to all the way to Khurasan. All of them were of al-mawali. They were the children of previous slaves. And that happened only in one generation. And that success was because at the time of the slavery of the Jahiliyyah, where people enslaved each other for many reasons, like debt, money, and debt enslaves him, and or war, regional wars of the tribes and so on, and many other factors. After that generation, immediately, the children of slaves became professors. And that slavery is becoming non-existing after that. Why? Because every family took care of a slave, made him part of the family, make him mawla, like Salim, mawla Abi Huzaifa, and so on. At any rate, this is encouragement. We have tons of problems nowadays facing us. Even we have over 6,000 universities. In the world, probably we have 20,000 universities. We have probably millions of people with PhDs and hundreds of thousands of professors. But look at our situation. Though I address, we are in the best age in 100,000 years. Don't get me wrong. In human rights and rule of law, et cetera, et cetera. But we still have poverty all over the planet Earth. 85 persons owns half of the planet Earth, as I read last week. Illiteracy covering all the planet Earth. Disease and famine all over the planet Earth. Wars claim the life of 250 million in the last century. Terrorism every place. Lack of security every place, hunger and strife every place, and at local levels, crimes. We have in the States over 4 million people behind bars. Most of those crimes are social problems. rape every second, abusing parents, don't talk about it, battered women. I'm surprised to read last 2 weeks ago that, as you know, Scandinavia considered the jewel of humanity in their, you know, civility and cultivation the highest level of, or not the highest probably, but what I read that in Denmark, 70% of women are beaten up. And this is the best, don't talk about other third world countries. Battered wives, abused children, broken bones. I was emergency room physician and I have seen all these horrible things. And where is the treatment? How can we solve this problem? Isn't it worth it to look into Islam and the how Muslims did this? Because Islam has zero tolerance to wars, to terrorism, to violence, to abuse of wives and children. And it's obligatory on everyone to be a factor in alleviating suffering, hunger and illiteracy and disease. It's worth it, in my opinion, to look into it. You might not, you know, adopt Islam as a religion as a whole, but there is wisdom to be learned from Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I mean, it's time to stop treating Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam the way has been treated on the planet Earth. It's time to stop that, because humanity give respect to criminals of history, tyrants of history, and they don't talk about them that bad like they talk about Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Why? We need to take a fresh look, and thanks God, I mean, I have witnessed in the last 40 years, there's a lot of change in the mood and the atmosphere. Regardless, you know, I know there's continuous feeding of this phobia against Islamophobia or whatever, and distorting the fact, taking it out of context and all of this, just to damage the reputation of Muslims. And here, I don't want to be paranoid about blaming the others for my problems. No, our problem is ours, and if we do not live up to the Islamic principles at all levels, of the personal levels, of the hygiene and the good look and the courtesy and the kind words and the helpfulness to others, widowed, old ladies and so on, or at every job, you have to give a little extra and be a little bit more nice, just because it's a recommendation of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When I am honest, when I am hardworking, when I'm punctual, then we have to, by doing this, we solve big problem. Dear brothers, last word, to be healthy is not to kill every germ around you, because germs everywhere, in unexpected areas, in everywhere. But when your immune system, when you're healthy, you don't care about germs. And we Muslims, we should be very keen on being healthy Islamically. Follow the commandments of our deen, our Quran, the hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. May Allah bless you all. Wassalamu alaikum.